So predictors are data element values that are automatically generated from samples of current and past data, depending on the periods you have specified to be included in the calculation. So we need to define what is our period that we'll select for generating this outlier or a predictor value. What will be the current and the past data? For what periods will we use them to calculate the predictors? So for example, for reviewing immunization data quality, predictors can be used to analyze previous data in order to generate outliers for future data. So this is a little complex, and for this academy, we will mainly focus on what a predictor is and how it is used, but we'll not go into the details on how do we create a predictor. But there is this link in the presentation for the manual, which will be helpful if you want to further create predictors yourself or learn more about predictors. But I can show you one example on how these predictors work. So say for generating a predictor in DHIS2, we say that we have to use the average for last 11 months and then 3 times the standard deviation. So suppose this is the way how we are calculating our threshold value. So then the periods would be 11 months that precede the last month. So for example, I am generating the threshold for December 2020. Then I will skip November 2020 and then last 11 months. So 11 months before November 2020 will be considered. So then we'll use December 2019 to October 2020 in my calculation. So this is the logic that we'll use for the threshold creation. And we'll just exclude any value that is an extreme outlier. So if we look at our predictor, so suppose I have to calculate the predictor, the threshold value for December. I do not consider the data for November. I consider the last 11 months, so which is December 19 to October 2020. The average of these 11 months is 122.8 and standard deviation is 16.4. So then my outlier calculation would be average plus 3 times the standard deviation, which is 173. So this we've already predefined in our application, the thresholds for the immunization example that we'll show. So then in this scenario, if my threshold or outlier is 173, that is my predictor's value, then any value if I enter above 173, so in my December data entry, if I enter 180 or 200, then it will show a validation alert that this is outside the threshold value. Using the generated outliers, once we have generated the outliers, we need to check our data to ensure that our data values do not exceed the outliers that have been generated based on the formula. So we can either use these threshold values which we are generating through predictors, or we can import the values from outside, say survey data or thresholds generated from some other softwares. Those values we can import in DHIS2 and we can use those values for our validation rules. So the process is same. We need to have a data element where these thresholds are stored. These can either be stored by calculating from predictors, or these can be imported from external software. And then we perform a manual check by reviewing the actual value versus the generated value. So we'll see them in the application in some time. This is just an example what we'll see. So suppose for Bagel Hospital, we see that RV2 doses given, rotavirus doses given to children is 6757, while our threshold that we have set up based on the last 11 months is 700. So then we can say that this value exceeds the threshold value and we need to go back and check this data. So it looks quite obvious that maybe looking at these values, maybe there's an additional digit which has been put in by mistake. So this will just help the user to see if there is any mistake, a manual data entry mistake in the data, or they can just cross-check and correct it. So how do we use these generated outlier values? If we go to each month's, each period's data entry screen and look for these validation errors, these might be difficult because you have to look at many time periods to assess the threshold values. So this may be difficult. However, if you want to look at many time periods, organization units and data elements together at the same time for consistency. And it's always easier to run these outliers through validation rule analysis. Though we will see an alert in the data entry as well, but since it makes sense to compare these outlier values for a longer period of time, it's more effective if we do this validation check through the validation rule analysis app in Data Quality. So we stop here to look at how do we run these threshold values in the application, while how do we configure these, we look at them tomorrow.
Hi, Deepika, we have a request to describe the predictors again. And a question, why no person read November data for the predictors calculation?
So I just understood we have to describe the predictors again. And what was the question?
Why no considering November data for the predictors calculation?
Okay. So, I mean, that's how these threshold values are configured. These are the standards that are being followed. And based on these guidelines, so if you look at the manual, there are these guidelines, what periods to skip, what periods to take in the count. So for our example, our logic is for predicting a threshold value, we don't take just the last month's data. We take the 11 months data before that, and we predict the values based on those 11 months. That's how the guidelines which is followed for this indicator, but I might not be able to drill down further on the conceptual thing of what periods should we consider for what kind of thresholds. I think there are a few details in the manual, but then we need to refer to guidelines for setting up thresholds for the different type of data fields. And just to explain the predictors again, so basically, we create a data element and we predict that what should be the threshold value. So say my data element is RV two doses, rotavirus doses given to children, and I have to set up a threshold value just to ensure
the
quality. Yes, please.
What if you want to calculate the predictor? Whose period of month are beyond 11 month? Like we want to create to calculate a predictor for 6 month. Well, yeah. Can't we succeed by doing so?
Yes, we can do that. So when we look at how we create a predictor tomorrow, though I will not go into detail on, we'll not practice how our predictor is being added, but I'll run through on how a predictor is created. So therein we can set up these values, that how many periods do you want to consider, how many periods do you want to skip in between. So we'll cover, so you can define if you want to use just 6 months, you can define that while you set up your predictor.
So it means that if you want to calculate a predictor for 6 months, we will not consider the last month, maybe if it's from January to June, it means that you not consider June.
So if you have to calculate predictor for July, so then your last 6 months will be the months preceding June.
Okay.
So December to May, yeah. Okay, so just a quick recap on the predictor. So this will help us assess what should be the threshold value. So we predict these values. So we can do a calculation, take an average of last 11 months data, add on the standard deviation to it, and show me what is the threshold. So based on that, it will say that, okay, based on your data average and what are the standard deviations, maximum should be 700. Your doses should not go above 700. Otherwise, it's an outlier. And so you could compare those values with the values. Now, these threshold values we have for this example calculated through predictors. But if you have these auto-generated through some other tools, we can import them in the same data elements. So if that's okay, should I move to data entry? So now we'll see an example of how do we run these predictor-generated threshold values and related validation rules. So for this example, I have selected Zweigle Hospital Gateway PHC, my immunization program. And now when I run validation, so I see for my DPT dose, it shows an error that DPT dose administered is less than or equal to DPT dose threshold. So now if we look at these monthly validations, though they show us that your value is exceeding the threshold values, but it's not easy to compare them on the data entry app. It makes more sense to go to the data quality and run validations there. So if I go to data quality and try to run this validations there, go to validation rule analysis in data quality, and maybe I'll select animal region for like last 3-4 months. And I take the immunization thresholds, validation rules. So here, and if we have made these rules for all, it will also run if there are zero values. But let me show you one where we have these thresholds. So if you look at this example, I will look at the details. So rotavirus 2 administered is less than or equal to rotavirus threshold, wherein it says that the doses given is less than, I think I've clicked on some other. I'll just show you one more example, which is more clear than this one. Okay, so I think we have data for January here. Let me just go back 2 more periods. So here, I think this is not showing value. There is some error on the message, but otherwise you can see that there's an error in the validation rule. My threshold is 700 and my value is 713, which I've entered. If I go into the details, it says this is a validation error for rotavirus 2 administered, wherein it should be less than the mean and 3 standard deviations of last 11 months. And I could check for this data if this is an outlier or a data entry error, and I can correct this data there. Since there are a lot of questions on predictors. I will, though we discuss this in detail tomorrow, but I will just show you how are these set up. These are the predictors which we can define in the application based on these formulas that we have. So if I open this predictor for DPT threshold values, so I can say that for every month I am calculating the threshold. So the threshold values keep on changing for every month based on last 11 months. And herein we define that how many months do we have to calculate. So sequential sample count means I have to take last 12 months and I have to skip 1 month. So that's where I'm saying sequential skip count. So for this formula, I just take the 11 months preceding the last month. So take 12 sequences and skip one. And then if I go to my generator, I have the same formula. I'm taking the average for the doses given in the last 11 months preceding, skipping the last month, and 3 times the standard deviation from the population where doses given. We'll come back to this tomorrow, but then this is where you could set in what are the number of periods that you have to take, how many periods you have to skip. If you don't want to skip the last month, you can just set it to 0 there. And the steps are same. So if you look at your exercises now, where the exercise 4 and 5 are for the thresholds, so you will be able to see where are the errors in the thresholds, and which will be further clarified once you go to the validation rule analysis and generate these. So are there any questions? If we take an example of where we were ourselves adding the value, so even then we'll have these data elements where the thresholds will be stored. We can just store those thresholds, and once we run the validations, it will show the validation based on those values. So predictors are populating for each month, but you could also manually push the values for these threshold data elements if you are using some external data source. If there are no questions, maybe we can give 10 more minutes for exercise, because there are just 2 exercises here, just 1 to check from data entry and 1 from the validation rule analysis. And after that, we could start with the next session. On the notifications, yeah. So please practice through the learner's guide and let us know if there are any questions.